Producciones Cartagena de Indias. Bienvenidos al Centro de...
Imágenes de la hermosa ciudad de Cartagena. Nos encontramos en directo cuando son las 9 de la mañana, 7 minutos iniciados.
This special broadcast, 30 degrees centigrade, in the capital of Bolivar. And here we are to give you details on the 6th regional platform of disaster risk reduction for the Americas, our third workday. This is a very, very busy agenda full of lessons learned and news for all of the attendees. 1,300 international guests here in Cartagena in the convention center. We're going to get prepared for the fourth plenary session and last one for this international encounter, which is in preparation for response and resilient recovery, progress and opportunities. This is ending, but we have gone all through risk management in our continent. That's right, Juan Carlos. Good morning to all our viewers in Canal Institucional via streaming as well. You have been with us in the 6th platform for disaster risk reduction during the past 4 days, 3 days. This is the for this regional encounter in Cartagena, where we have had several important topics in terms of risk management for disasters, not only for Colombia, but for the entire American continent and for the entire world in general. We must highlight that we have good comments as a country from the Office of United Nations. They have highlighted our national risk management system in terms of disasters in Colombia, the strengths, opportunities, and all of the development that will come in the next few years. We cannot disregard that we've never stopped. We continue to be stronger every day, and we are preparing ourselves to be more resilient in the country and in the Americas. In that sense, we begin our plenary session number 4 under the framework of this 6th regional platform for disaster risk reduction. We leave you now with Ana Maria Escobar, who has more details on this plenary session number 4. Ana Maria, please. Juan Carlos and Carolina, thank you very much. Good morning, everyone, our attendees. Before beginning plenary session number 4, we invite architect Ivan Caicedo, subdirector of risk reduction for the National Unit of Disaster Risk Reduction, who will read a summary of our plenary sessions and parallel sessions in day 2 of this regional platform for disaster risk reduction in the Americas. Good morning, everyone. In the framework of the second day of the 6th regional platform for disaster risk reduction in the Americas, we developed 2 plenary sessions associated to the second and third priority of the regional action plan and Sendai's framework. 9 parallel sessions, 2 for each of the priorities, 2 or 3 of the regional action plan, 1 for each priority, 1 and 4, a special session with experiences developed in the Caribbean, 2 cross-cut sessions, and 1 technical associated to the progress of countries in terms of the compliance of their regional action plan. Our sessions began with the development of plenary session number 2, articulation of global agendas, climate change, disaster risk reduction, sustainable development, and in regional planning, sub-regional and national and local planning. The conclusions of this session highlighted elements that are common to global agendas and that we estimated as a priority for the present and the future. This includes regional experiences that show us the integration of the climate change agendas, disaster risk reduction and sustainable development goals in the application and development are all possible. Global agendas highlight the complementary and comprehensive nature of our agendas. We have seen that we can have national plans and follow-up mechanisms that articulate these agendas. We will have to have a political will to consolidate institutional arrangements that allow to have a comprehensive approach of our agendas in terms of climate change, disaster risk reduction and sustainable development, and the mechanisms for their follow-up. In plenary session number 3, investment and resilient management, we acknowledged the main progress, challenges, and recommendations in terms of disaster risk reduction, investment, and strategy for financial protection to have a resilient infrastructure guaranteeing continuity of our key services. We had 2 parallel sessions associated to priority number 2, strengthen governance of disaster risk reduction. Parallel number 7, implementation of Sendai's framework at the national level, national plans and legislative frameworks, and for 10, instruments on planning for disaster risk reduction. We could see the significance of having a disaster risk reduction policy assisted by a planning instrument and funding instrument that operate as guidelines to manage disaster risk. We could see that we have significant standards and regulations associated to disaster risk reduction. This includes articulated processes with the different government sectors at the local, national, and social level. As a priority, we have decided to work on an inclusive approach. We have to guarantee that people that are vulnerable, like childhood, indigenous populations, people that are under a disability condition, and other vulnerable groups are included within public policies. It's important to transfer knowledge, just as the policies, with ethnic considerations for each country. This is how we highlight the significance of the social approach in development planning, considering key points, articulation of different development instruments, strengthening the different funding schemes, the inclusion of risk management in public investment, the sectoral articulation and institutional articulation, evaluation reports for by control entities, alert systems, and the characterization of risk through information systems such as risk maps. Parallel sessions 11, incentives and instruments to foster resilient instruments, and 14, public management for financial risk and disaster attention associated to priority 3, investing in disaster risk reduction for resilience. We had different instruments to support decision-making related to disaster risk reduction as development instruments. In terms of the inclusion of disaster risk reduction in public investment, we concluded that we need a regulatory framework that is strong and that mandates incorporating risk management in public management and its cross-cut involvement in all development instruments, allowing their management. In terms of financial inclusion, it's crucial to have immediate funds after disasters, and we identified the following instruments that the countries in the region have developed, and the need for progressing in terms of knowledge and measuring risk to analyze the cost effectiveness of the interventions, the need for identifying alternate sources and permanent fresh resources that can leverage the development of a resilient infrastructure, and the need of lowering pressure because of the use of financial resources of a public nature oriented towards development, construction, and reconstruction of infrastructures. It will be necessary to strengthen evaluation and follow-up processes, unlink all of the political methods, so privileging others, and strengthen schemes to have more flows of investment and lower the pressure on central governments. We highlight the National Public Investment Network, chaired by Costa Rica. We signed the commitment of 22 countries in the network in the National Public Investment System to strengthen risk management in public investment within the region. In the session on risk analysis, we determined there is a lack of integration and methodologies and appropriation of information generated mostly in countries with low income. That's why it's important to improve risk communication so that people can act upon them and strengthen their information system so that data is stored in places with easy access, facilitating understanding of information. In addition to this, we advance in priority four, increasing the preparation for disaster cases to provide an efficient response and better rebuild in terms of rehabilitation and reconstruction. With parallel 12, human mobility and displacement by natural disasters and adverse effects of climate change, we saw that disaster risk reduction under a monetary context develops complex issues like human mobility in development of adverse situations, disaster situations associated to the adverse effect of climate change and variability of the climate. These intervention scenarios show several challenges like the processes of evacuation, internal displacement, cross-border displacement, migration as an adaptation, migrants that cannot return, migrants that are trapped in disasters. Experiences that we showed conclude that we have to close the gaps in terms of cross-border movement and migration. We have to look into multilateral agendas. It's politically sensitive, but human mobility in terms of disasters are a priority situation that requires specific actions to reduce the vulnerability. The session on international cooperation mechanisms for risk reduction and emergency response, where we highlighted the significance of developing cooperation models that are dynamic and allow to generate an effective cooperation between the parties and use humanitarian cooperation of regional stakeholders. The region is a pioneer within national policies with integrated systems connected to sustainable development based on principles of solidarity, sovereignty, respect and cooperation. The cooperative spirit is also visible in social networks and the Academy of Science and Technology for risk reduction. In this session, the Americas shows the need for legal frameworks that uses the sector of science and technology in national systems for disaster risk reduction. We require to compensate the differences in investigation, in research in North, Central, and South America and the Caribbean, and use science and technology in a bidirectional way, from theory to practice and from practice to theory. That's why it will be key to acknowledge the science and technology sectors as a relevant stakeholder when drafting public policies that will have a territorial impact. In terms of the special session in the Caribbean, we showed the need for establishing a Caribbean route for resilience. As a collective action for the region, recognizing that there will only be resilience with a joint effort of the insular states. We have five critical pillars. Pillar one, social protection for the most vulnerable ones. Two, infrastructure protection. Three, economic diversity. Four, environment protection. And five, operative preparation. In terms of supplementary spaces and all of the different topics in this six regional platform on disaster risk reduction, we had a side event where local stakeholders in disaster risk reduction and humanitarian action shared their experiences on leadership in Latin America as an example of empowerment and appropriation of response actions and construction of resilience in our communities. We also generated 20 official declarations from different countries, organizations, local, regional, and international universities, civil protection, amongst others, with specific commitments working for the community, for youth, for childhood, and projects for water management, actions for climate change, and fostering risk management offices at a local level. We finally had the second session of the regional action plan, where there was an agreement in terms of generating spaces for the next platforms that allow to show countries all the progress obtained in the implementation of the regional action plan, and as a region, the analysis of priorities and initiatives that require an evaluation for becoming stronger. With this intense but productive session, we continue to confirm the commitment of countries and organizations, the communities in the region of the Americas and the Caribbean, in the voluntary implementation under the framework of Sendai and the consolidation of a less vulnerable community with more resilient communities.
A continuación, damos
we will la now welcome the fourth central plenary session known as Preparation for Response and Recovery, Progress and Opportunities. In this plenary session, we seek to acknowledge the best practices in the region around readiness and preparation for response and recovery, identifying challenges that limit recovery and response. In this plenary session, the moderator will be Mrs. Janet Fernandez Castro. She's a specialist in post-disaster recovery in the program of the United Nations for the Development, UNDP. Since 4 years ago, her main task is related to the implementation of a global project that fosters the use of the harmonic methodology PDNA and formulation frameworks post-disaster in alliance with the European Union, the United Nations, and the World Bank. As panel members, we've got Carlos Iván Márquez Pérez, General Director of the National Unit for Disaster Risk Reduction. Alexis Cruz, Director of the Economic and Social Analysis of the Ministry of the Economy, Planning and Development in Dominican Republic. Jocelyn Lance, Coordinator of Resilience and Rapid Response for Latin America and the Caribbean. General Director of Civil Protection and Operations of Humanitarian Aid from the European Union. Tania Quinillo Quintanilla, National Chairwoman for Cruz Verde in Honduras. And we finish with Ricardo Toro, National Director of ONEMI Chile.
Damos paso ahora a la moderadora Janet Fernández Castro.
Open for Janet Fernández Castro.
Muchísimas gracias. Buenos días con todas y todos.
Good morning, everyone. I would like to thank the attendees for being with us in the development of this fourth plenary session, where we will discuss aspects related to the preparation of response and post-disaster recovery, considering the progress in the region in the last few years, and also considering the opportunities to strengthen this topic for the future. This session is a result of the joint efforts between the Risk Management Unit of Colombia's government, the Office for Coordination of Humanitarian Matters, OSHA's, the UNDP, and the Disaster Management Network. We would also like to thank the United Nations for Disaster Risk Reduction and the Colombian government as a host in this event. This morning, we have five panel members that have strong experience in the topics we will be discussing. We will start the session with three short interventions of our panel members. We will, after that, have a round of questions. In this case, the moderator will ask questions to follow up the presentations. And then we will see a short video to have a short transition with the second portion of the session, where we will have the presentation of two additional panel members. This will be followed by a short round of questions by the moderators. Finally, we expect to have at least 20 minutes so that the audience can ask questions directly to the panel members. And for this, we will try to use the mechanism we've been using in the other sessions in application so that you can send your messages, and we will have the chance to write your questions directly, and they can be collected by our organizers. Before I begin, I would like to quickly give you a bit of context around the situation between this process, managing emergencies, and the preparation for emergency management and recovery management, and why they're important for Sendai's goals. As we've heard several times, risk management is a continuous process that requires an analysis and intervention that are comprehensive and not fragmented. This is how Sendai's framework for disaster risk recovery stresses risk reduction against disaster management. In this sense, priority four is increasing preparation for disaster cases to have an efficient response and better rebuild in recovery, rehabilitation, and restoration. We expect to contribute to the framework's goals and the seven global goals, mostly looking into reduction of mortality caused by disasters, reduction of the amount of people affected, the reduction of economic loss, and the reduction of damages caused by disasters, mostly in basic utilities that have an impact directly on our communities.
On the other hand, the new focus of the United Nations has been detailed in the summit back in 2016, which is known as the new manner of work or the new ways of working, which calls for a reduction in the gap between humanitarian stakeholders and those who work in development. The experience gained by the humanitarian team has been very efficient in saving and protecting the lives of people, while the world of development has lots of tools that can strengthen our solutions to problems and give added value to joint work. The purpose, the ultimate purpose, of course, is to increase resilience in communities in the face of natural and man-made threats. In this continuous work of risk reduction, the agenda offers a unique opportunity to prepare in terms of response and recovery. In this sense, there are many different common points that will allow us to optimize the use of human resources as well as financial resources to generate a higher impact in all of our interventions. For instance, both the planning of response as well as the planning of recovery can be done ahead of time by way of multi-threat damage situations that may dimension the demands of the affected population, the most damaged services, the geographic areas, and the social groups that have been most impacted. Some other points of convergence may be the management of data and information, the identification of early recovery needs, the identification of national and local capacities along with key stakeholders, the identification of economic areas, geographic zones, and priority demographic groups. And of course, we need to lay down the basis for recovery-related needs. Recent events in our region, such as those occurring in Mexico, Colombia, Peru, the countries and territories of the Caribbean, and recently Guatemala, make it evident that natural disasters hit harder every time, and they call for better responses with effective planning tools, data management systems that allow for the decision-making process, and funding processes that pave the way towards resilience. As indicated before, the option of this session is to get to know through examples and best practices from the region how countries are facing up to these challenges, what kind of specific actions we've taken to advance responses, what is being done in terms of anticipated planning in recovery, and the harmonized group between the humanitarian and developmental stakeholders. Lastly, of course, it is interesting to get to know how global, regional, and binational cooperation can actually contribute to improving capacities, the capacities of the various stakeholders so that we can undertake these tasks. The session seeks to highlight the examples and best practices in the countries of the Americas. After this introduction, I would like to welcome our three first panel members, Firstly, we're going to have Carlos Iván Márquez, who is the director of the National Unit for Disaster Risk Management in Colombia. He's devoted his professional life to generating a Colombia that's less vulnerable with more resilient communities. Carlos Iván is a specialist in financial management. He's an expert in risk management, international humanitarian law, aid and disaster, as well as logistics in operations and attention to emergencies. He has never put aside his work as a scholar and professor in different universities in Colombia. Until 2016, he performed as the chairman of INSARAC, the International Counseling Group for Search and Rescue for the Americas, and the coordinator of a strategic line within the Action Plan for Humanitarian Aid Coordination in the at PAHO, also for the Americas. And I'm going to read a little bit of a summary of the resume of the other two panel members. Tania Trimiño, throughout the past 18 years, she's worked on humanitarian issues in a voluntary manner. He has garnered numerous recognitions and lots of work in integral risk management, humanitarian aid, gender equality, principles of protection of persons in emergencies, response processes, and recovery transformation processes in the midterm and in the short term. She has worked with the Honduran Green Cross since the year 2000. She manages the areas of shelters in emergency situations like COPECO, which is the Honduran Civil Protection Agency, as we know, and she advises around risk management, water, sanitation issues through the WASH certification. She has experience in formulation of processes and community processes, facilitation of workshops, and so forth around the issue of capacity building with communities to integrate not only in terms of response but also recovery. And thirdly, I have the honor of introducing Ricardo Toro, who comes from the National Risk Management Direction from Chile. He's a division general from the Army. He's retired. He graduated as a higher state officer, and he has graduate degrees, master's degrees in business management, human resources, and strategic planning. Amongst his duties in the Army, he actually became the second oldest official in the Army, and he was stationed in Haiti, and in the exercise of his duties, he coordinated the first 72 hours of the actions after the earthquake in Haiti. He was entitled the director of UNEMI in 2012 and ratified by the President of the Republic in 2014. He works for the high security system, whose position was renewed for another 3 years as of November of 2016. So I would like to welcome our first panel member, Carlos Iván Márquez.
Bueno, muchas gracias. Buenos días para todos.
Thank you so much, everybody. Good morning. I would like to take this opportunity to share a few elements that we've used in Colombia with regards to response. Let us remember that response to emergencies has been laid down by our disaster management policy as two joint elements when we have a special situations. This term is the mind, but I heard Felipe, who's here in Mexico, a master among those that I followed all of my life, and in one of the meetings with the OPS, he said that no country is obligated to receive what they haven't asked for. And yesterday, I made a reference which is not mine, but I actually admire, I admire him, and I have him in my thoughts. How can we guarantee successful preparation for response and recovery? Okay, we first of all can state that this actually happens under a consolidated national system and is supported by a national risk management policy. That's the secret as a system, and on that basis we have developed that. And as a mechanism of coordination, we generate the fundamental elements, which is basically disaster management, coordination, planning, funding, and information. That's key. That's also management. Disaster management is an administrative duty, and we need to be clear on the aspects to see how far our capacities go. Colombia has a system, and I'm going to talk very briefly because I'm going to focus on certain information, and we need to look at the manifesto of our country in this regard, please.
Hoy siento que mi compromiso es más fuerte. Siento que nací para ayudar y aportar. Sé que mi vocación es también la de muchos. Y dispuestos a entregar todo. Somos miles, miles de colombianos trabajando unidos. El conocimiento nos hace responsables. Conocemos cada amenaza. Estamos dispuestos a reducir el riesgo. Afrontamos cualquier circunstancia. Recorriendo cada rincón de nuestra geografía. Nuestra misión es estar siempre presentes. Somos más que una fuerza. Somos un equipo comprometido para hacer de Colombia un país menos vulnerable. Somos el Sistema Nacional de Gestión del Riesgo de Desastres.
Muy bien.
Okay, so this is the manifesto that we have as a country, which has been built over the course of the past 8 years, and which is the system's mandate. But the important also is to advance in terms of standardization, and we have accomplished an external classification with the methods used internationally, which are basically the CHARAG guidelines. That's an example of classification. And in that respect, I would like to tell you that those exercises were developed with a thorough process. Colombia is one of the first countries that generates a response team on a nationwide level by integrating all the different components of the system. So that's what we saw in the manifesto. So along those lines, we comply with a classification process. We developed that this year. We made a review with all the instructors, with all the sequences. We established a commitment of a practical exercise with activations, with monitoring mechanisms. Everything was developed in terms of real mobility with our institutionality. What you see in the background has been good for practices, but also for attention. That's why we have gone around most of the Americas. And in addition to that, we established a base of operations with the Red Cross, with the Colombian Red Cross, and in 36 continuous hours, we reached the last part, which is something essential, which is to basically manage to get in Colombia the first classified team, which is internationally accredited on an intermediate level, and in addition to that, it's actually the fourth one in the Americas after the two in the U.S. and Chile and Colombia, of which there are 52 in the world. This is an assembled capacity from the point of view of commitments, of preparing for a response, and also for us to be ready, to be available under this scenario of actually having two very important mandates. First, respect for victims. If we want to supply care, we need to have the capacity, we need to have the instruments, and we need to have the scientific basis. That's something similar to that. We need to have the people, the equipment, and the possibility of moving fast to take care of any emergency situation. In that regard, the country has established an internal accreditation or internal classification system, which is being developed under national standards and also international standards. We have been pioneers in proposing that the whole accreditation classification system should have two components, the international and the local ones. And in Colombia, we just put that forth in Geneva early this year. And now Colombia has two internally classified groups, one from the National Police Force and the other one from the Bogota firefighters. And I talk about this mechanism because we made a lot of mistakes in the past, but we actually learned from those mistakes. And by way of example, we can now manage the different systems according to the circumstances and the requests that we are presented with, either nationally or internationally. Okay, thank you. Let's have a round of applause for our first speaker. Good morning. I'm really glad to be here today. Warm greetings. We're going to talk a little bit about the experience in readiness and response by way of a capacity building system that we have established in Honduras since 2016. Okay, to say that the Honduran Green Cross is a non-profit means that it's actually focused on emergency services, pre-hospital care, first aid, first aids, and also numerous specialties. We are members of the National Disaster Risk Management Office, which is part of COPECO, the Permanent Commission for Contingencies. We mainly aim at various tasks based on the kind of care that we supply. And in that respect, we establish different actions and we develop different projects by additionally inserting those efforts into the communities where that has been necessary, because lots of conditions were occurring and additional efforts were called for, which was actually provided through various cities that were remote from the target areas. And that's been an initiative from communities themselves to actually establish a Green Cross base in such areas? Okay, in this regard, okay, since 2016, as I was saying, we have been doing this type of exercise, which derived from the need of establishing ourselves as the Honduran Green Cross, because we detected that we had a lot of reluctance to receive new volunteers or new first aid workers, but we were actually leaving out the reinforcement of capacities among those people within the institution. So from that perspective, as of 2016 and up to 2020, we decided to strengthen the capacities of our volunteers and our first aid workers, of the people who were supplying all of the important aid, with the objective of strengthening our response. So we planned the whole strategy to try and inclusively contribute to the development in the consolidation of first response care processes, humanitarian aid, and we actually are making a lot of emphasis on socialization, capacity building, strengthening our responses, and also early recovery, as well as humanitarian assistance, which we were providing by means of our institution.
The involvement of several stakeholders towards participation in these processes has been carried out in a way in which we are achieving another goal, which is to insert this preparation in early recovery processes and for the long term. Somehow in a friendly way, in harmony, in consolidation of all stakeholders, we have the insertion of capability transformation processes, which means basically that we are taking this first aid or emergency assistance and humanitarian assistance, we're taking it to people who didn't have the possibility of being trained in Honduras Green Cross Cruz Verde actions. We have a few tools that have strengthened this action, and this has been done because there has been a joint gamble with specific steps to reach the transformation of vulnerabilities. For each of the people that are involved in the communities, like, for example, Mascamoa, Bejuco, Potrerio Cortes, we have highlighted the responsibility and the commitment, the voluntary commitment, and it's necessary to highlight this, to be able to continue with this entire process that leads us to improve the first community response. There's some points of encounter that I would like to highlight so that the communities so that these stakeholders are key in emergency response and in disaster recovery. We're talking about planning and coordination. To that end, we have also involved another additional process, additional to the capacity strengthening plan, where we are inserting within them protocols and procedures, specific ones actually, to manage the different emergencies or response before disasters that may occur within the communities. It's also necessary to say that we have a continuous training process, and to that end, we have empowered, and also in addition to the budget, we have decided to strengthen the technical capacities and to move forward with these people. We can work with several areas or a specific syllabus to strengthen the capabilities. That's why we talk about water and sanitation, hygiene, wash in English, and in it, we are seeing positive results. We are supporting the communities in cleaning processes. We are creating awareness around solid waste management and several actions that will strengthen the response. I would also like to say that it's necessary to have an effective communication, an honest communication that will allow for these people to know that there is a legal framework that Cruz Verde in Honduras abides by, as well as other SINAHED organizations. To that end, we know about the need for empowering these people through several communications, like being like legal frameworks, protocols, procedures, and some sort of agreement, regulation, or decree that may be in harmony with first response.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Ricardo, por favor.
Ricardo, may you please? Good morning. Although my presentation will be more towards response and rehabilitation, especially the technological elements that we are incorporating, undoubtedly this is not different from what has to be in prevention and what is fully connected to this. That's why I'm going to talk about general matters that are important to consider. First of all, how does Chile face emergencies? It does it with the state structure and with all of the public private members of the state or of this element that allow more capabilities in our system. For prevention, we organize the Civil Code Committee and the Response Operations Committee with three coordination principles that provide mutual support that even goes to international requirements. This coordinated by a National Office of Emergencies, which is what is advised by the authorities and the systems and coordinate the systems to face emergencies. We'll talk about management, planning, and early alerts. They're key. I don't want to go into detail here, but when we talk about SINDAI's framework, there has to be a connection from the national policy until the common or the community level in prevention and in the emergency plans for response. And in that sense, that connection allows a coherence and an organization in the actions of what we wish to establish. And I would like to highlight the significance of sectoral plans, where each ministry and organization has to have a unit that includes disaster risk reduction, its projects, and its matrix plans, aligning the public sector, the private sector, NGOs, and civil society to have a specific panel for risk management. It's also important in terms of prevention to establish training for the population through different evacuation exercises, school plan, inclusiveness, and also working with common leaders, community leaders, through different programs. Yesterday we talked about all the factors underlying risk and defining the level of risk I have in a specific circumstance through Chile Preparado. The intense use of social networks through websites, Facebook especially for prevention and education, and Twitter mainly, communicating what's happening every day in an emergency, minute by minute. This has to be integrated and has to have a sequence so that countries can properly prevent what is to come. And this should be the reason of what we will talk about next. First, an early alert system that has a 24/7 center throughout the country based on the national level with an emergency committee that is built according to the severity of the emergency. And we also have technical tables that will allow to channel threats and follow-up of decisions that the emergency committees carry out. This with critical emissions and satellite information that make sure that the centers in the country are permanently communicated with a coordination with protocols, with technical organisms that are key for monitoring emergencies, and that they in turn develop their own technological capabilities to secure proper monitoring and an alert system that goes from the activation of the system, the use of alarms, and the alert system through phones that allows to communicate what will happen to the population. And we go now to response and rehabilitation, where through a table I want to explain how the sequence that we've established and the technology we've been including has an impact. First, we have an emergency. We activate the system, the alarm, and on it we will have the mobile phone alert system. There's a population that evacuates and that is trained not only because of this alert system, but it's trained to know what to do. And here's the first problem. The first problem is when we have the Emergency Operations Committee and we start with the uncertainties, which is the first instance of having to receive information. And that's why here we've established the visor for risk management. I don't have time to look into the details, but this visor has all of the critical infrastructure of the country to be able to make decisions in hospitals, electrical central offices, what prioritizes the actions of the system to solve the problem that has to be faced. That's why it's a tool that has to be permanently up to date, and we have to work on it. After that, we have the basic points, recovery, which is what is called rehabilitation of basic services and the viability of paths. In a public-private coordination, we established a common database with the ministries, with the superintendency, with private companies, so that there is an integration of the database and that the population only receives one piece of information and not what the private companies provide or the ministry or superintendency. We have unified this and we've established protocols that show that through this platform we can be oriented. And then we have the preparation of response in the logistics part and in shelters, points of encounter. They're all key. In the first part, in logistics, we use our logistics system, which is world-class, and it allows to integrate all of the information so that we can have coherence and interrelation between what we are using. We've incorporated technology to have tracking in the entire system of what we can be using. Therefore, this technology is what we invite to implement. And here with UNDP, we've done everything, including adapting Esfera Chile, with water sanitation, and it should be related to our reality. It should contribute and develop shelters that don't occupy schools, because one of the ways of going to normality is by using these spaces. And the most important point, I believe, is the damage assessment. Here's a huge problem, because when we don't have a good system, this is very disorganized and we don't know what has to be provided to the population. And here we designed a system system that can raise the needs and provide solutions through a platform that allows to integrate all of the members of the ministries that are working on this matter, and a sheet with a disaggregated population that's not only at the general level, but it should see all the variables that this implies. And to finish, it's important to understand that the volunteers, this is a solution, but sometimes a problem when they're not well organized. Same as donations, when I request aid by channeling the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And for that, we established this app where we can know the tasks that are assigned to our volunteers, their cadastre, when they're working, and how I unite this to the entire system. Finally, I'm going to go to the last part. The effectiveness of response is what shows a prospective risk management. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Ricardo, y a los tres.
Thank you very much, Ricardo, and all of the panel members for looking into time as well. We'd like to offer a chance to extend a bit more on what, on your topics. Maybe I'll start with Ricardo, because we just heard his last presentation. The use of technology is very important, as you've shown here, not only to manage emergencies for immediate rehabilitation, but how that platform, where we have sectors, we have territories, so we have a horizontal and vertical coordination. How can that platform be extended a bit better to be used in an effective and efficient way for planning the recovery in the long and midterm? Not only rehabilitation, but maybe extend yourselves a bit more integrating other stakeholders in these processes. In Chile, we've separated the emergency since it happens until the rehabilitation. And the rehabilitation is what we believe it's key to have this database I've just presented, because almost everything that existed before was for threat levels or emergency levels that didn't have an impact in the degree we're seeing it today. And that's why we need that technology to integrate it and see what we have to do. In terms of the reconstruction after the long term, undoubtedly we are looking into it as well, because there's decisions that are made in an emergency to seek a solution for those that are affected. That will be something that will determine the final decisions. And we have to be very responsible in this, because many times this expression of information that we require has to establish the priorities that the action framework has. And we have to recognize the government, invest in the risk, and better rebuild. Avoid that if they build, they're within the parameters. And hopefully, with the solutions should be part of what will come to the future, so that there's an integration. And this data that is base is key, because I would, to be honest, here in the in an emergency, you can see greatness and also the opposite. So those who were affected by emergency should have a solution, and we have to have an organized system that's systemized and integrated. And each organism should not be working independently. We have proven with this integration of our databases that many times there's efforts in parallel receiving two or three benefits because there is no proper planning. That's why I connect this. If we respond at the beginning in an organized way, we will be able to see consequences as, that are similar. Along the same lines of your experience in managing emergencies, preparations, drills, how can these experiences also contribute to strengthen these mid and long-term experiences? Experiences, to have a clear structure, we have to think about formal mechanisms and structures. Managing emergencies isn't, we just started running and trying to basically serve everybody as soon as possible. So when we talk about this organized mechanism, we're based on the aspects that we've established. First, an emergency has to have the support, legal support. We have to think on whether it's local, national, state realms, even with national support. In Colombia, we have a mechanism which is public calamity. It's a mechanism, national or public calamity, until we reach a disaster. Actually, that's a different level. So the key scenario we have to look into is the registry of those impacted. And it's a registry that's given from the perspective of damage assessment. General Toro has mentioned it. This is a very important mechanism because based on this registry also have a sectoral impact. And this generates something important. It's a specific action plan depending on the magnitude. It will have the integration of sectors. In Colombia, for example, in Mocoa, we have a specific action plan for 3 years, a COMPES as a support, a funding of 1.2 trillion pesos to reestablish the entire impact. In practical terms, we generate aspects that have to happen from the scenarios of simulations and drills. It's very important. That's why the drills we've seen that are carried out here, we had CIMEX last year in Bogota, we had CIRU. These are drills where we work in scenarios and also at the table to implement the capabilities and remember the protocols and use tools, equipment, accessories, and the coordination system. That's something that is key.
The population involved in all of these drills. Here, every year, we do a nationwide drill in October, where we do that not only in the face of seismic threats, but also depending on the setting, people start to see that as part of their own commitment. And their commitment is actually to their own life. But the essential purpose is to generate through this readiness work going into action. And yesterday I was also remembering that we are pretty clear on our skills, our commitments, the contingency plans, but whenever we need to activate those, oftentimes we tend to forget what's ready, which is a contingency plan, and we start to assemble other coordination mechanisms. So we need to bring that down to earth for everybody, because when we're talking about a nationwide situation, that gets everybody's attention. So the intention is to bring the whole thing down to earth and use what we already prepared from the drills. And something we should not forget, humanitarian aid is based on search and rescue, which saves lives and stabilizes the situation, taking care of people with dignity. And that implies using international standards. Here in Colombia, we have our humanitarian aid guidelines with different standards, and there is something else that is important. We operate as a state, and when that's the case, there are people who help coordinate, such as, you know, different government offices. It is a duty, and to be effective by covering the needs of the people impacted, in the midst of all of these this organization scheme, something important should prevail. Whatever we do should be done immediately. We should not get paralyzed while doing an analysis. This is called readiness to response and also recovery, so that when something happens, we can work fast and without any hindrances. And that actually implies effectiveness in our commitment, but it also that also transpires by means of coordination. I would like to finish by saying this. A response occurs because behind that response there are human beings, institutional harmony, confidence, critiques, and every single step of the way we have human analysis, and we also utilize the different schemes. But that's the important thing. Empathy and commitment actually make processes work on the basis of coordination, which is something essential. And we're asked, how do you establish civilian and military relationships? We don't have those anymore. We used to have them, but we don't anymore. It's all about coordination now. I'm not the boss of any force. I just coordinate. As the head of the office, I coordinate. Military officers, they have the command. And from civil agencies, what we do is coordinate. We coordinate people's willingness, and that can be reflected by things such as the manifesto that we were just shown. Okay, and to get back to a point that you just mentioned, all of these exercises, all of these drills have an essential purpose. They must be aimed at people, at human beings. In that respect, and from your experience, Tania, how do we make these processes center around people by means of the training processes that you're generating? Can you please explain to us how you empower people and families so that they can engage into these processes? Okay, it is essential to say that first off, we have to carry out a diagnosis. What we can see is that the volunteership, because our agency depends on volunteers, actually we're losing out on that across the country. And if there are people willing to give their time away, willing to give their knowledge away, and also become empowered. At that time, it was necessary, and it still is, for us to strengthen these individuals. It is also important to say that that's all based on commitment. It is based on personal commitments, which these people have actually extended to their families, to the communities, everything that the Green Cross has been able to provide them with, which is essentially to strengthen their capacities, get to know one another, socialize, and also disseminate knowledge and raise awareness precisely on the fact that they are human beings and it's lives what they have in their hands, and that they can actually make a difference. In those cases, it is also pretty hard at some point to do teamwork unless everybody is fully coordinated, unless everybody agrees on coordination. Everybody should get to know the coordination mechanism within any response, be it a routine emergency or a disaster type emergency. So in this case, it is also necessary to engage people into everything agencies and organizations are doing with a lot of common sense as well. We need to explain that emergency management can only occur through the coordination of a civil protection system, but we're actually keeping a close eye on the actions that they are rolling out at that particular moment so that they themselves recognize and relate to the teamwork, the kind of teamwork that's being done across all the various organizations which are members of the whole system. Okay, we now invite you to view a short video clip that is going to show the transition between emergency management and recovery.
Muchos países alrededor del mundo se encuentran ahora más que nunca decididos a construir un mejor y más sostenible futuro.
To build a more sustainable future, but disasters keep on threatening that future by destroying hospitals, schools, livelihoods, and employment opportunities. Recurring disasters drive millions of people to a permanent cycle of humanitarian aid and recovery. But things don't have to always be that way. Recovery after a disaster can actually be an opportunity to better recover and to grow stronger. Institutions can be constructed to withstand future threats. We can diversify livelihoods, and basic and social services can be more accessible. At UNDP, we work with various countries and communities so that we can prepare to what can happen and also be ready to face up to the recovery process. This implies identifying common objectives ahead of time, identify capacities to recover after a disaster, or strengthening institutions, human and financial resources to implement long-term recovery processes. All of these joint efforts guarantee that recovery is actually inclusive, fast and efficient, and most of all, that we can make the best of it to avoid future disasters. While we do our best to mitigate risks, we also need to make sure we make make the best of the opportunities that recovery offers. Together, we can prepare for recovery. Thank you so much. So we're going to carry on with the panel session, and we're going to invite our two next speakers. I'd like to call upon Alexis Cruz, who's the director of the Counseling Unit of Economic and Social Analysis from the Planning, Economy and Development Office of the Dominican Republic. He is a PhD in economics from the University of Surrey in England. He has a master's in economics from Santiago de Chile University and a bachelor's in economy from the Santo Domingo Technical Institute. He has performed as a director of the Planning and Development Office at the Banking Superintendents of the Dominican Republic. He's a tax specialist from the Technical Secretariat of the Government and advisor of the Embassy of the Dominican Republic in the UK. He has worked for the State Bank in Chile, among others. He has taught at various renowned universities, not only nationally in the DR, but also in others such as Flaxon, international ones such as the University of Surrey and also University of Chile. His academic work has been published in specialized journals of international publication. And our very last speaker, Joseph DeLance, he's the Resilience and Quick Response Coordinator for LATAM and the Caribbean, General Direction of Civil Protection and Humanitarian Aid Ops in the EU as of 2015. Josh Lance has over 30 years of professional experience. He worked for the private sector in Western Africa and for 5 years with NGOs and international agencies, mainly in Africa and Latin America and the Caribbean. He has worked at DGECO for 20 years in the LATAM and Caribbean regions, having started in Honduras after the impact of Hurricane Mitch. And since then, he's worked on the implementation of humanitarian aid from the EU, emergency response, disaster risk reduction in Central America, South America, and the Caribbean region. He has a graduate diploma in applied geology. He wrote up his thesis about hydrogeology in this University of Sciences and Technology of Besançon in France. So first off, we're going to hear Alexis out.
Buenos días.
Good morning.
Por sesgo de profesión me voy a concentrar un poco en hablar de
due to my profession, I'm actually going to focus on the DR for the past 10 years. The Dominican Republic has grown on average about 5%. It's had a reduction of the poverty rate from 39.7% down to 25%. It's also reduced multidimensional poverty from 34% to around 23%. However, the nation's geographical position has led it to be impacted by various atmospheric phenomena, mainly storms and hurricanes, as well as earthquakes, although that hasn't happened in the past few decades. So what did that lead us to? The impact of two hurricanes, which didn't even touch down in the Dominican Republic, but they actually grazed some neighboring countries, and it led to a it led to the reactivation of the economy, and it actually grew at a certain rate. But after the two hurricanes in 2017, growth was about 4.7%, with its respective impact on the pricing of farming products and essential products. Obviously, we have had a lot of tax impacts after hurricanes. We're talking about $1 billion, the kind of impact that we've had. The biggest one was from Hurricane David, which was a 16% impact on the GDP. And by late 2016, a series of rainstorms happened in the DR, extending to 2017, with its respective impact on the nation's GDP. Now, within the legal framework in terms of disaster management policies, which is part of the political charter of the nation and our development plans, and Law 14702 on disaster risks. Now, with regards to response and recovery, the social policy coordinator has developed a vulnerability index in the face of climate change that has allowed us to identify vulnerable families in a condition of poverty, and we actually started a social protection program. However, obviously, all of this has a cost for the nation. We, from the Planning and Development Office, have also rolled out a methodology by crossing this vulnerability index with data from the census and from the National Plan of Income and Expenses, and we've identified homes that are vulnerable to floods. And as I said before, resources are limited to by a series of factors. Within that context, it is important to assess what the economic, social, and fiscal impact is from natural disasters. And with the technical assistance of the World Bank, we have created a consultancy team to do an assessment that led us to the implementation of a smartphone app. When an event is declared, we have a series of volunteers who get the information, and they receive a code that is enabled, and then they go to different sectors. For instance, the education sector. The person who raises the information goes to a specific school with their cell phone, with the GPS system. Immediately they identify the place where they are at the moment. That information is uploaded immediately to their phone, and they know the number or name of the school, and then there is a catalog of prices, which is going to determine what the damage sustained by the school was. For example, the collapse of a wall, the cost is right there. They have to snap at least 5 pictures, and when they have access to the internet, that information is uploaded into a server which is connected to the Planning and Development Agency, which looks at all of the sectors. However, the Education Ministry is only going to look at their own sector. The Public Policy Office is only going to look at their sector. We also need to look at the economic impact, and it allows for different sectors to have sector-based data.
Bueno,
okay, I also wanted to say that this is the direct damage, the direct impact of disasters. There is something that we're developing with the UNDP and with the EU to look at all of the indirect and social impact. Also with the World Bank, we're rolling out a methodology to look at the impact in terms of poverty. I wanted to show you a few pictures about the post-disaster reconstruction. The ones at the top is a whole village that is called Boca de Cachón, which is close to a lake in the Dominican Republic. In 2003, the surface of the lake was 265 square kilometers. However, now, in 2018, it ranges between 350 and 375 square kilometers. There is a lot of hypothesis which has not been proven yet in terms of how the lake or why the lake keeps growing. But we've relocated a number of families and we've built another village which is much more resilient. The pictures at the bottom is basically a neighborhood in Santo Domingo which is called La Barquita. It has 1,400 families. They were living under a bridge near a navigation river. And every time there was rain, their house would flood. They were given resilient infrastructure, and families were relocated. In terms of progress and opportunities, we have the creation of the consultancy team to measure economic and social impact. Also, after 2017, as part of the national budget, we included an article which every time something like this happens, we can increase expenditure up to 0.5% of the GDP. Also, we have a contingent loan line with the World Bank. In case it is necessary, the president declares an emergency situation and we can make use of that loan so that we can face up to the emergency. Obviously, there are many different challenges that we're supposed to confront as a country. Among those, we should be able to build post-recovery capacities, and constructions are supposed to be better able to withstand climate change. We've made a lot of progress in terms of policy planning, but we need to advance, define, and implement risk management models, both before and after.
Recomendaciones que se hacen a esta hora desde la ciudad de Cartagena y lo que tiene que ver con la gestión del riesgo, no solamente lo que se ha realizado en Colombia, sino también en América, todo el continente presente acá en la capital del departamento de Bolívar, Carolina. ¿Qué se viene en horas de la tarde?
En horas de la tarde tendremos el acto de cierre de esta sexta plataforma regional para la reducción del riesgo de desastres con todos los países invitados, con los altos dignatarios que nos acompañaron durante estos tres días, y esta ceremonia será transmitida a través de Canal Institucional, 3:30 de la tarde en punto. Los esperamos acá para el cierre de esta plataforma, Juan Carlos.
Claro que sí, ahí estaremos. Además, recuerden, a las 9:30 de la noche también volveremos con ustedes para entregarles todos los detalles de lo que ha pasado durante estos tres días de trabajo. Completo resumen, recuerden la cita a las 9:30 de la noche. Hasta entonces.